So I think so for the question answers, I would personally start from Soma. I think so the wonderful presentation what you made and really getting onto the crux of the issues what people are facing into the side. My first question would be, out of the issues that you see onto asset managements actually, how much do you see the issues related to the design flaws and how much are the man-made, where the workmanship flaws actually? Is there some distinction that you have been able to see or study something? Where is the differentiator? Is it on the design side or is it in the execution side?
Yeah, thanks, Amit. And you know, you and I would like to compliment your presentation. We really took us in a different plane altogether. So thank you very much for that. Now, coming specifically to your question, we haven't done a detailed analysis as such, but from the data, whatever actually we have collected so far. So my take is that the design flaw, when I say design, it's a boardroom design I'm talking about, the SLDs, the bill of materials and all those kind of things. I think that is not contributing to much into this entire system. So it looks like more of an workmanship here. Like for example, we have seen the cable crimpings, even inside SCBs. See, it goes through an heat cycle usually, right? So people, when they are selling you the SCBs, it wouldn't have gone through that heat cycle. So we have seen it, once the SCB is exposed to the temperature of Rajasthan, those terminations, the connectors, I think over 2 months of time, it needs a bit of tightening in addition. This is the way, again, I give the analogy of the car because everyone understands it. He says after 1,000 kilometer, do the first service or 5,000, right? So like that, these are some small things to be taken care. Now, I don't think this should be considered as a design, isn't it? But I would say this one important thing, the handover takeover, that is missing. Meaning the project or the EPC team does it, now actually the project is handed over, right? The way we get an instruction manual for any equipment we buy, I think for an EPC, the design team has to give how the project should be taken care of. I think that is missing. Now, I don't think I can categorize that into design, isn't it? But yeah, otherwise majority is workmanship, the labor issues, Amit. That's my take.
Yeah, sure. You can add. I think so what I could understand is rather than design, it's workmanship as well as the protocol of handover or systems and procedures not being defined. Yeah, and so that a person who takes over the asset is not really sure how he should maintain the asset, what frequency, what he needs to do on a regular basis to see that asset keeps performing. Right. Is that okay? Mr. Paapaarao also has a question for you.
Mr. Somashekhar, thanks for the excellent presentation. Normally, the solar plant is supposed to last for 25 years, particularly in the ground mounted. It is what you called like a chanceless, divorceless marriage. So you have like, we have health fitness like this. You have formulated any sort of a checklist or something every monthly basis or quarterly basis so that whether you are there or not, the technical team or even a layman can understand and maintain the plant. So that makes simpler for the power plant owner, IPP.
Mr. Paapaarao, thank you very much for the question. Yes, we do have a big bunch of checklists. Which has evolved over a period of time depending upon the plant sizes. And in fact, now we are also consulting the EPC. We have defined an HOTO process, that is handover takeover process. So we go through that or actually our technicians go as per that checklist and do all the maintenance process. In fact, going one step ahead, we have now come up with a tool. See, we are all talking about SCADA. That comes automatically, the data. What we saw is there are a lot of manual activities happening in the field, which is not tracked. So we have implemented a school, something called SPIDAR. We haven't actually kept it to the market yet, but we are using it in-house so that it is basically a combination of an app and a back-end cloud server here. As you all know, the most dumbest of the person also carries a smartphone these days, right? So he has downloaded the app. So daily he does an inspection. The checklist is in his app. He ticks, this has been done today, and he need not enter it anywhere. So we get it at the back end in our server. So we look into this data. So this is one of the recent innovations of Avisolar, we have done it.
And most of the times at the sites, the SCADA is not working. That is the common complaint.
Absolutely. That's what I said, yeah. So yes, you're absolutely right.
So in terms of scenarios and all, like what is the
best way as an O&M service provider, you are protecting the interest, rather you are possible measures to protect the interest of the IT.
Yeah, so SCADA has come a long way. It's not just I'm promoting my company. So as Amit said, we all have a piece of cake here, but there are a lot of these wireless SCADA systems where easily we can retrofit. Again, I don't want to name a project in one specific airport project, not yours, Amit. The SCADA is not working. We just actually replaced it and the trial run is now going on. Not the entire thing. They said it's a wireless unit. So it's a retrofit also is what we are doing it. This is IoT has been a buzzword, if all of you know, right? It's much simpler to collect the data, at least from the inverter. The inverters are all compatible with the standard Modbus protocols. You just have to have I think Reddington fellows were here, the data loggers, or actually we have also cloud-based software or a portal. So retrofit is very easy. As an O&M service provider, we recommend that have the SCADA installed.
Thank you. Thank you. I think one wonderful thing what you mentioned about is using the increase the compliance probably using an app. Yeah, if some you ask any layman or a worker to keep filling the reports at the end of the day what he has done, there will be reluctance all the time from the labor side actually doing all the paperwork because he's more tuned to do something by hand on the field rather than putting it on the paper and reports. So with mobile-based apps, I think so, you have made their life easy. Absolutely. And maybe your percentage of compliance also would have gone up in terms of reporting is concerned. Yeah?
Yes, yes.
Okay. I think so, my next question would be for Mr. Paapaarao. You have been focusing more on the rooftop solutions in South, especially in Tamil Nadu, you are looking. How is the...
More in the Western.
Western, okay. How is the cost pressure? Today, if you see... Tariffs are going down, the demand for the EPC prices are going down, and it's a never-ending story. Yeah, every negotiation you go, probably the benchmark cost has dropped down further. Where do you see, is it really leading to the compromise in quality, or is there any optimization onto the material and components which is helping to reduce the cost to such extent?
We always work at Godrej at optimization of technology. Because if they say EPC player is asking at say 45 rupees and he says I want only REC panel, I want only SMA inverter, if he puts his entire complete checklist, it is not possible. Yeah, it is not possible to maintain both ends meet. Ultimately, we are all in business, so we have to make profit at the same time, make customer happy. So we always call it the optimal design. So we give the solutions to the best of our possible. And we say that, look, based on your specification and the price budget, this is the best we can offer. And we are very happy to lose the orders also, because for us, the brand and trust is more important than the order.
And Godrej can afford to lose orders.
No, but the issue is, as you said, we can afford to lose order. But suppose we take on less price and we do something happens, then we will hit the headlines.
Absolutely.
No, I think so that's very imperative for the brands to really caution as to work with the caution because they are carrying a huge amount of legacy behind them over and above.
The headlines tomorrow.
Yeah, and probably the loss on the stock exchange would be far more higher than the loss in the solar business probably. Yeah. Okay. My next question would be to Mr. Pasupathy actually. While your presentation, I saw a couple of airport projects you have done as well as even seaport projects. Any typical challenges that you faced while doing such projects in places like airports and seaports? I believe it's not a very simple and very easy place to work around.
Yeah, that only minor. This one we have observed is actually while working with the government authorities, getting approvals, permissions, and to work even in the holidays. These are all. Very, very difficult. Actually, our deadline will be there and we have to finish the project in 1 month and all the holidays, all the this one, and also the late evenings, you are not allowed to work. There are a lot of these things, you know, approval procedures. Then in the harbors and airport, that wind and sometimes very horrible, that environment will be there. And other thing is, one interesting thing we learn from this one is after we do the installation, after 1 year, we have observed there is a big layer of dust And what happened, we just want, that as usual, we have applied water and other thing. Then after 1-6 months, it became a sticky issue. It became stick, the dust got stick. Because what happened, that's not a normal dust. The vehicle and truck dust along with that salty, moisturized air. So we tried anyway this one and it's not going. And actually LD class is there. That see, like every year, this one we have to give this much of output to the end client. Otherwise we are liable for deduction of how much units we are getting less. That many number of amount will be deducted from our performance money. So we have to be innovative and we have approached the heavy power tech and we found an innovative mechanism of the nano coating. We have removed everything and we applied one full layer of nano coating to the entire panel. So it's a learning curve. Like these things, no? Like I'm installing for 9 years. This is the most unique experience we got. So with that, now onwards, for any such kind of project, before we get the product, no? So we are asking them to apply nano coat and bring it. Maybe it costs a little more, but it saves a lot of our time and energy.
Interesting to know that, because I have never come across any of the installation with nano coat. We have been hearing about a lot about this technology, but never heard about anybody actually using it. So maybe my next question will be on the same. While doing this evaluation of putting the nano coat as one of the possible option, have you evaluated what is the life? Is there anything different that will happen onto the module just because I am putting a layer of nano coat to reduce the dust accumulation into it? What's the expected life, and has there been some evaluations done already based on which you took the decision?
Yeah. But actually that decision we have taken after discuss with the vendor and the vendors, that European partners also. Similar instances have already occurred to them in any of the European countries, and they have solved the problem by using this technology. Plus the vendor himself has given the assurance, if at all anything happens, we are responsible. So it's like a back-to-back agreement. And we have done the job now nearly more than 1.5 years passed. That output is also good, plus the dust is also not sticking on it. The dust comes, if you just wipe it or wash it, then the dust gets go off. Before what happens, it forms a layer, then we cannot able to see the bluish. It becomes white in color. People are shocking to see the panels.
I have a question with your permission to Pashu. In Bangalore, the buildings itself have started collapsing. Okay, yesterday also there's a 5-star building which toppled. So now, being in a rooftop, in fact, two questions. One, what kind of load analysis do you do on an existing building wherein, you don't even have a data of actually how that roof has been built? Number one. Second is, what kind of liabilities or actually LDs you really carry if at all some catastrophic event happens?
So that's a good question. I have answer for only number one question. Because number two, I have not yet experienced, only the number one. For the existing building, any of the existing buildings, to be honestly speaking, they don't have any drawings or layout or what is the beam strength or what is the analysis. Only roughly we can able to take, and the only analysis what we do is the StatPro analysis. That StatPro analysis gives you a fair amount of reasonably, okay, how the distribution of the structures, and if you apply that much of 8 tons or 6 tons of load on the building, at least we can get to at an extent. But very honestly speaking, with that existing structure, lot of buildings are not having any information, nothing, only with some assumption, mostly with some assumptions and this report, StatPro analysis, we can able to do.
I think, Soma, I'll add to what answer Mr. Pasupathy gave. Typically on the rooftops, actually, there are two of analysis what we do. The most important is dead load as well as live load. Yeah, these are very important things. Dead load, normally most of the buildings are able to qualify because it doesn't go beyond 20-22 kgs per square meter. So if a person is going to go up onto the building and stand, the building is already qualified because at least you will have a weight of 50-55 kgs. Yeah. So dead load is never a problem. The live loads are a problem, and live loads are a problem because the wind has that tenacity of, as we are actually, if you see an industrial roof, we are creating a tunnel. By putting the module on to following the slope of the roof, we are creating a small tunnel. And when the wind gushes inside, the uprooting force is far more higher than the dead load actually. Yeah. And so what we need to definitely do is for a given specific location, for a specific orientation of the roof and particular angle at which you're going to mount, you need to work out the live load and see whether the live loads are capable, as the structure is capable enough to take that live load. And if it is not, then it's not worthwhile going ahead, because any one incident, it will not only that the modules will fly off, it will take the structure along with it actually, and which will be huge, huge detrimental actually. Yeah. I think so. We had enough questions amongst ourselves, and I think so. I should definitely ask for the audience if they have any questions. Before one of the last question I'll ask you, Soma, I'll keep it reserved, but let me go ahead with the audience. If there are any questions, please identify your names and ask the questions to specific panelists to whom you need an answer.
Preventing. Yes.
What is the preventive maintenance?
So preventive is, one is, you know, you can do a thermal imaging for which you need not really disconnect loads so that your generation is going on. So that would give you an indication that at least the hot spots are not being developed. When we do a thermal imaging, we see that sometimes the hot spots are just 5 degrees on top of it. Then we know that actually something is happening. Now, how to prevent it? We don't have a solution. So you need to actually really contact the manufacturer, which usually we haven't seen a good response yet, because the manufacturer is telling me, see, the degradation has not started yet. The performance is good. Once the performance goes down, actually we'll get in is what they are pushing the question. So that's the only thing we have.
I think so. The hotspot, if you already have seen the hotspot, it's the start of a problem actually. Correct. Yeah. And the reason of having a hotspot is that there is some impurity into the cell right from the wafer or from the ingot time that it has been carried. And there is a place in the entire cell which is becoming a sink rather than a source. Yeah, this is a non-conductive material, a small portion within an entire cell, which means rest of the cell is generating while one small portion is not generating, and there is a sink and source which starts heating up that one portion, and that is leading to the hotspot, which means that the panel is really going towards a direction which might lead to the claim in future. So early detection through IR is the best way, but once you see some problem into the IR in terms of hotspot detection, I think so you should start chasing with the manufacturer that there will be issue in coming days.
Yes, that should be fine. Again, you know, we cannot define it. It's like, you know, how often you should go to the doctor. I cannot tell 1 week or 2 weeks, but yes, the more you do, if it's affordable.
In your experience.
So in our experience, you know, we kind of do it as of now, it's once in 6 months only. Because again, you know, it costs money. We don't put the money. The developer don't want to give it. So currently once in 6 months.
Sir, all of us would like to see that we achieve 100 gigawatt target is achieved, and then we all grow together. All this can happen. There are many policy issues needs to be policy needs to be changed also. I feel one such area which is a major concern for all of us is a distribution area. See, the distribution companies all are monopoly. Monopoly, how you will wake him up? It is very, very difficult. All distribution companies in India is making loss. It is known. Will he improve so just like that, keeping him as a monopoly? You do any amount of thing, he will not improve. Whatever subsidy you give. See, generation was a problem. It was taken out. Monopoly status was removed. And the competition introduced, generation now plenty of generation. Transmission, competition is introduced, and situation is much better. Similarly, distribution, competition introduced, and situation is much better. Now, coming to retailing. Retailing is with DISCOM. Tangedco, you know, anybody dealing with Tangedco, you know. Similar is the case with the Bangalore Bescom or any state. What is the solution? Introduce a competition, then you will improve. what was the case of BSNL 10 years back and now? Now BSNL is running for his money, so BESCOM or Tanjatko has to run for its money. Is it happening now? Nothing. Unless you do that seriously thinking and create a competition, like Chennai, there should be a 3-3 discount minimum. Then customers should be able to choose the company. Then only you can find the solution. This is a major thing. Discom is not able to buy the power. So much potential is there. Whether Discom or whether Tangedco or Bescom or anybody can buy that power, all are making loss. They're giving money after 10 months here. After 10 months, 8 months, whether the situation will improve. So
thank
please,
you, thank you so much, sir. You have any question or
the, for, no EQ and other? Please take up with the government, particularly central government. Bring a competition with the DISCOM. Then only this 100 gigawatt target. This is one of the major area needs improvement.
Thank you so much.
This is my humble.
I have something in this comment, sure, connected to this comment, if you don't mind. I think your dream is going to come true very soon. Okay. And this is my thought. Okay, I don't know what's going to happen in the policy, and I don't know what's happening. But think about number of people in this. Think about the exponential growth that is happening in the industry. And just imagine, with so much of rooftop happening, and every industry, residences, multiplexes, commercial complexes, practically everyone is thinking of going for rooftop. For one major reason, apart from being renewable, is solar energy is becoming more economical as compared to the grid power that is being available. With so much of energy being available in the morning, that is sunrise to sunset, you have more power available than required because grid power cannot be shut down. You cannot switch on and switch off the coal plants. Nuclear power plants have been operational, whatever are operational, new plants are stopped. Now what happens for the rest of the time? So over a period of time, we're talking so much about net metering, that metering is required, this, that, etc. Grid is going to have so much of excess power at a time, and then they're going to have suddenly a drop of availability when the power, for various reasons, is required of 24 hours. Now, at one point or so, all of us have already become generators, right? All those rooftop, let me complete. So all of these generators who are on the rooftop, utility scale, whatsoever, are ultimately going to become a generator, and there's going to be a lot of uncertainty based on the weather. On one day there would be a better generation in Bangalore, the other day there would be better generation in Chennai, and some other day there is going to be higher demand in Hyderabad. And all of this has to be synchronized. The grid is available across the country. So the next step that is going to happen is deregulation of this monopoly, which is unavoidable. The government, over a period of time, will have, and the, something that we just spoke some time before that I was talking about, is about innovation. The 24 hours renewable firm power is the only solution. And as much as, and a lot of work is happening on this field. I'm sure some of those who are working in this field are aware of it. There's a lot of hybrid power plants which are getting built. A combination of reverse hydro is being worked out. A combination of solar, wind, and reverse hydro. A combination of less dependency on grid. And how well can minimum coal-based power plants be maintained by which the firm 24 hours renewable energy can be maintained is what the work is happening. Even our company is working on these kind of projects. So over a period of time, there would be time, probably you have a solar rooftop on your house, I have a rooftop on my house, and maybe I wish to go on a holiday and you have a function at home, so you need extra power which is available with me, which I don't need. So there is a need of a platform which can, irrespective of you and me know each other, we are able to share our that excess power. Sorry? OLX of power. There would be exchange of power which would be privately available. This deregulation is not too far from now.
Thank you, Sunil. It's a wonderful explanation. Yeah.
One of the oldest rooftop in Bangalore, big scale, is on our Chinnaswamy Stadium. Must find it kilowatt more than 3 years. Any feedback you have on OLM or
No, I do not have any feedback. Sorry? Yes. Correct. No, they haven't. Yeah. No, we don't have. We are not maintaining that plant. No, thanks.
Yep. So if no further questions, maybe we conclude the session. Yep. Thanks. One more question.
Mr. Kumar, in the railways particularly, majority of the stations or where you are building the rooftop solution, whether it is 40 kilowatt or 100 kilowatt, each building maybe on an average, the age of the building is minimum 50 to 80 years. And the roof will be more or less asbestos or whatever it is. And you have multiple challenges, like for example, you need to take approval from the electrical department, and since building belongs to the civil department, you need to take the biggest. So I'm very keen to hear about your experiences.
Excellent. You asked the right question. And actually, it's my engineer who has actually done the job. He has faced all the problems what he told. Because each department is unique. Civil, mechanical, electrical. In electrical itself, there are multiple electrical wings. Building belongs to one person, the LT belongs to one person, the ST belongs to one person. Even if you finish the job, you cannot able to put it into the grid because that approval has to come from central office, head office. So in fact, it is all for the, what do you call the way of life, and we have to find out a mechanism of the how to get the things and make it happen. And regarding the roofs, what he told, actually in railway stations, we were allowed to do, see like this, for example, Bangalore. So it's a 1 megawatt we have done. In 1 megawatt, mean not only in the main Bangalore, in Yashwantpur and the DRM office, Harsal office and other office, and whichever roof which can able to fit in, which can able to withstand that load only, we can able to do. And a lot of buildings we have looked. Actually, the orders was more, but we could not able to do more because of lack of availability of space constraint. So whichever buildings which can able to withstand only, we can able to take. So with lesser capacity only. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Pasupathy Kumar. Thanks to all the panelists for a wonderful contribution in terms of presentations as well as question answers. I think so, Anand, you can take that.
Thank you very much, distinguished panelists and audience. I think the conference was very, very informative, and like we have been organizing on the same topic in every city, but in every conference we feel some different aspect or issues comes up. So indeed it is interesting for us also to keep this series running and keep on doing in different cities and bring out new and new issues. So definitely Chennai was very, very interesting, and I hope the market grows in a phenomenal manner in times to come. Definitely there are some clouds over the deployment of solar power, like safeguard and anti-dumping. All these issues are definitely very genuine, but we need to have a very smart way to sail through these times to keep the pace of installations catching up. So thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Big round of applause for distinguished speakers on the dais. I'll take this privilege and opportunity of requesting Amit ji to present small mementos to all the speakers on the dais, please.